Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Jerry O'Donnell, professor of theater, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to the inauguration of Dr. Hamid Shirvani as the 7th president of California State University, Stanislaus. And I'll be your narrator for this afternoon's undertakings, and the academic procession is beginning as we speak. Before we get underway, please join me in a round of applause for our wind ensemble, which performed the prelude music. The academic procession is led by Dr. Al Petrosky, Chair of the Academic Senate, and Dr. John Sorrell, Chair-elect of the Academic Senate. Dr. Petrosky carries the university mace, which makes its debut today, and is a symbol of leadership and authority. Immediately behind the mace are the delegates from CSU Board of Trustees, educational institutions, learned societies, and professional associations. We are honored to have them join us for this inauguration. Following the delegates are the CSUS Stanislaus administration and distinguished faculty who are marching by rank and length of service. The faculty represents our academic colleges as well as our graduate school, counselors, and librarians. The final group is members of the Platform Party. The Platform Party includes Chancellor Charles Reed, Roberta Achtenberg, Chair of the CSU Board of Trustees, representatives from the state and local government, representatives for the faculty, staff, students, and alumni, as well as Father Rafael Loevano, who will deliver the invocation, Father Joseph Elo, who will deliver the benediction, and Mr. Jerry Stead, who will deliver the investiture opening remarks. Finally, in the place of highest honor, is President Shirvani. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, would you please join me in welcoming Ms. Roberta Achtenberg, Chair of the California State University Board of Trustees.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I'm very pleased to be part of the inauguration of Dr. Hamid Shirvani as the 7th president of the California State University Stanislaus. My colleagues on the Board of Trustees offer their greetings and congratulations on this most auspicious occasion. Joining me today to celebrate this inauguration are my fellow trustees, Dr. Carol Chandler, Dr. George Galgani, and Mr. Andrew LaFlame, one of our student trustees, whom Stanislaus can be proud to call its own. Today is one of the most festive celebrations in the life of a university. Faculty are attired in their academic regalia, and the day is filled with tradition, excitement, and promise. Stanislaus has had a tradition of leadership excellence, and there is no doubt that Dr. Shirvani will continue this tradition of leading California State University Stanislaus as one of the nation's best regional public universities. Dr. Shirvani knows that leadership is the capacity to translate vision into reality. And today, as chair of the Board of Trustees, I am honored to see someone I admire as a leader and academician be inaugurated as president of the California State University Stanislaus. I thank you.
Would you now please rise for the presentation of the colors by the Turlock High School Navy Junior ROTC and the singing of America the Beautiful with the university's concert chorale. Please remain standing for the invocation.
Thank you.
I'm now pleased to present Father Rafael Luabano of the Archdiocese of Orange, who will deliver the invocation.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your divine hands boldly carve the San Joaquin Valley from this land, and you are the source of its great fruitfulness. We ask you now to send forth your blessings upon the California State University Stanislaus, which claims as its home this wondrous and rich valley. This afternoon, Lord, we ask you to bless all who have gathered here for this joyful celebration of Dr. Hamid Shirvani's inauguration as the 7th president of California State University Stanislaus. The arrival of a new president signals to all faculty, administrators, trustees, alumni, a season of renewal of their service to the university. Grace them with new and united purpose. May peoples of every faith and culture delight in the welcome of this community. May all who come to work and study freely and productively pursue their dreams on this campus. We especially pray for all students of this university. Quench not only their thirst for knowledge, but ignite in them a passion for truth. And may this flame of truth burn brightly within them all of their lives. We offer thanks for all past and present benefactors of this university. Reward them generously for their great generosity. Lord, you have called your son, Hamid, to lead this community. Now, pour forth your spirit upon this gifted man. Grant him all the blessings requisite for outstanding service, leadership, and inspiration. Endow his spirit with the virtues of wisdom and strength. Move his heart with the gentle graces of humility and compassion. Engender in Hamid the deep desire to serve others. Give him good health and peace of heart. And Lord, with the task you have set before him, preserve Hamid's love of life. Tickle his sense of humor often. Let your son Hamid richly savor the sense of accomplishment that only comes from a job well done and completed with respected colleagues. Under the leadership of this new president, forge this academic community with the courage both to face the challenges of today while envisioning an extraordinary future for this university. With the leadership of President Shirvani, raise up California State University Stanislaus as a source of inspiration and service for the San Joaquin Valley, our state, and beyond. Lord, we also pray for Hamid's beloved wife, Fatima, as she accompanies her husband in his university presidential journey. Grant your beloved daughter, Fatih, the gifts of strength and patience. Grace her with continued loveliness and fill her with happiness. During Hamid's tenure as president, increase Fatih's love for her husband. Finally, Lord, we pray for an end to the war in Iraq. Remember those who have died for our country and those who offer military service at home and abroad. Hold closely, Lord, the families and friends of those who faithfully await the return of their loved ones from war. We also remember the sick and the poor and the immigrants of our state. We pray for those who long for knowledge and the empowerment that only education can offer. And as we prepare for elections, Lord, we ask you to bless our great state of California with leaders who will serve our people well. Father, we give you thanks for your many faith traditions, and I humbly offer this prayer as we do in my religious tradition. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, amen.
Thank you, Father Luevano. I now invite representatives from the campus and community to deliver greetings. The first speaker will be Dr. Al Petrosky, Speaker of the Academic Senate for 2005-2006, and Professor of Management, Operations, and Marketing in the College of Business Administration.
Not long after the arrival of President Shirvani, he called for the creation of a new seal to officially represent California State University Stanislaus. The adoption of this seal can be seen to symbolize the beginning of a new era for the university under Dr. Shirvani's leadership. The seal is composed of four elements: a book, the CSU motto, Vox Veritas Vita, a tree, and a lamp. Each of these elements in turn can be seen to represent the essential qualities of the university and its various constituents. Today, each of our campus representatives will describe one of these symbols and how it informs and honors the university. As the faculty representative, I will address the meaning of the book. The book symbolizes knowledge and learning. The creation and sharing of knowledge are central to the work of the faculty and, of course, to the mission of the university. President Shirvani contributes to these endeavors with his stewardship of the university's affairs and also as a professor of art and architecture in the art department. The art of teaching necessarily involves learning. Whether in or out of the classroom, we are all at our best if we approach each situation with the attitude of a learner, open to each other, to new understanding, and to knowledge. President Shirvani has already earned the respect of the faculty. He is an engaged leader who has the best interests of the faculty at heart.
Presenting greetings on behalf of the staff is Ms. Filomena Wojciechowski, Chair of the University Staff Council.
The motto of California State University, now incorporated into Stanislaus' seal, is Vox Veritas Vita, Voice, Truth, Life. Through their support of the learning environment and advancement of the university's mission and goals, the staff members of California State University seek to embody this motto. We look to President Shirvani to guide and direct these efforts, to give voice to our voices, to speak the truth in all matters, and to empower our ideas in order to generate life-affirming change and development. We have found President Shirvani to be a caring and involved leader who enjoys a positive and productive relationship with our staff.
Thank you. And now presenting remarks on behalf of our students is Ms. Chelsea Miner, President of the Associated Students Incorporated.
Our university is happily located in the heart of the Central Valley, one of the richest agriculture regions in the world. And the tree and the new seal represents this important heritage. It also symbolizes the promise and potential for growth. I am proud to note that the students have already had an opportunity to work with President Shirvani to promote the university's growth in an important and exciting way. President Shirvani from the beginning has worked to engage and involve students in the governance of this university. As students, we appreciate President Shirvani's dedication and enthusiasm for the development of our university. I personally have enjoyed working with President Shirvani on projects. More specifically, at the beginning of the semester, President Shirvani presented his vision for a new student recreation complex. After months of collaborative work, the students voted overwhelmingly in early May to approve a fee to build this new facility. On behalf of the student body, I extend thanks to President Shirvani for his leadership and look forward to a fruitful future. Thank you.
Thank you, Jason. It's now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Todd Barton, president of the California State University Stanislaus Alumni Association and a member of the class of 1998.
The lamp and the seal symbolizes truth, but for me it also symbolizes the light the university sends out into the world each time it graduates a student. In addition, it symbolizes lifelong learning, the influence of the university beyond the classroom. With over 36,000 alumni, California State University Stanislaus has spread a strong and enduring light throughout the state, across the nation, and around the world. We appreciate President Shirvani's approach to reach out to the community and to his pragmatic style of moving the university onto the next level. On behalf of the Alumni Association and all alumni, we look forward to a continued partnership and bright future. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Presenting greetings from the city of Turlock is Mr. John Lazar, member of the Turlock City Council.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being here on behalf of Mayor Kurt Andre, who had to be at the mayor's conference down in Las Vegas today. He wanted me to extend greetings to Professor and President Shirvani. He appreciates the energy and enthusiasm in reaching out to the city of Turlock, particularly in the efforts to rename Monta Vista University Avenue. We're having great discussions about that, and we look forward to continuing that dialogue. In behalf of the City Council, the Mayor, and the citizens of Turlock, congratulations and every best wish in your success. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lazar. I now invite Ms. Melissa Moyer, who is representing Congressman Richard Pombo, to the lectern. It's a little bit of a walk, so just talk among yourselves.
I'm happy to be here today on behalf of the congressman who was unable to make it. He proudly sends his congratulations to the new president, and as such, we would like to present him with a special certificate of special congressional recognition in honor of your inauguration as the 7th president of California State University, Stanislaus.
And representing Congressman George Radanovich is Mr. Gary Soiseth.
Good afternoon. As was mentioned, my name is Gary Soiseth, and I am here representing the Honorable George Radanovich. On May 30th, Congressman Radanovich formally acknowledged his excitement with regards to Dr. Shirvani's acceptance of his post here at California State University Stanislaus. I would like to take this opportunity to share a few words that were entered into the congressional record. Mr. Speaker, I rise to honor Dr. Hamid Shirvani, President of California State University Stanislaus, upon his inauguration, which will take place in Turlock, California on Friday, June 2nd, 2006. As the 7th president of California State University Stanislaus, Dr. Shirvani will look to further the quality of educational offerings and research activities for the San Joaquin Valley. Dr. Hamid Shirvani has successfully led restructuring efforts of several colleges and universities, resulting in an increase in the number of students enrolled, applicants, classes offered, and overall funding. As a university leader, Dr. Shirvani has effectively managed regulatory and governmental issues. An innovator in the classroom, he believes that integrating technology into education is vital to the success of higher education today. Mr. Speaker, I rise to honor Dr. Hamid Shirvani, President of California State University Stanislaus, upon his inauguration. I invite my colleagues to join me in wishing Dr. Shirvani many years of continued success. Again, on behalf of Congressman Radonovich, we are eager to see how Stanislaus State will mature under your guidance. Thank you.
And representing Congressman Dennis Cardoza is Ms. Lisa Montaro Moore.
Congressman Cardoza regrets that he was unable to attend today. He was really looking forward to this joyous celebration of continuing this academic tradition in our community that has brought so much to us. Dr. Shirvani, we're so glad to see you at the helm of CSU Stanislaus. This is an incredible facility. I am very proud to say I'm an alumni, so I really love doing that part of this. This is a great, great institution that offers so much both to the students and to the community. And Congressman Cardoza has been delighted to be able to support the university, its activities, and to see its growth and maturity throughout the region and even in the nation. This is a great honor today to be able to watch the inauguration of the new president of the institution. So with that, I would like to present you a congressional award, which one you've already heard, so you'll have some time in the congressional record. And thank you for your service to our institution.
It is now my pleasure to introduce State Senator Jeff Denham, who will present a proclamation on behalf of the California State Senate and the Assembly.
Thank you. It is my privilege to be here today to honor my friend, Dr. Shirvani. We welcome you to our community, and it is a changing time in this state. We've been seeing it now for the last several years, and it looks like it will be several more years of drastic change. We look forward to that very same change here locally, and look forward to continuing to work with you in the Senate. There'll be many education issues that come up, as well as chair of the Ag Committee. I know that there will be much that we can work on together. It is just my privilege to be here and honor my friend and to present you with this resolution on behalf of Assemblymember Greg Agazarian and the California State Senate. I'd like to present this to you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I present a special musical selection performed by the University Concert Chorale, who will perform the Credo from W.A. Mozart's Mass in C minor.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. It is now my pleasure to introduce Mr. Jerry Stead. Mr. Stead is the executive chairman of IHS Incorporated and former chairman and CEO of Ingram Micro, a graduate of the University of Iowa and the Harvard University Advanced Management Program in Switzerland. Mr. Stead has served on 30 corporate boards during his career. Mr. Stead is also a close friend of President Shirvani's, and we are honored to have him join us on this auspicious occasion. Mr. Jerry Stead.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here and share with you this afternoon some of my thoughts about my two favorite subjects, my friend Ham and leadership. I've been fortunate enough, as you just mentioned, to know many great leaders. And over the years, I've been fortunate enough to have led over 300,000 people with the corporations that I've been CEO of. So I think I have a pretty good impression of what it takes to be a great leader. I will tell you, as I've known Ham in the years of the past and today, he has developed and continues to develop into becoming a truly great leader. You at this university are indeed in for a ride of excitement, a ride of pleasure. I was delighted that the father mentioned that his wife, he was praying for patience for you, because somebody needs it in that family, I want to tell you. But that's what helps make a great leader. When I think of great leaders, I think of four or five things, and I want to share those with you and tie those in with what I see with my friend Ham. First of all, Ham believes that every person must be treated with equal dignity and respect. And you'll, excuse me, you'll see that over the years, that he truly does that. He believes that great organizations like this university are only as great as every individual or every team member, and every team member must be given an equal opportunity for success. Secondly, he starts with an assumption of 100% trust of every individual he works with or who works for him. He operates with what I think of as the three P's: power, permission, and protection. He provides the power to people to make the right decisions and be successful. He provides the permission to take risks, to do things differently, to learn, and the protection when people make mistakes, as we all do, to learn from those mistakes and start over. So I think of him with those three P's day after day: power, permission, and protection. Third, I think of him with an incredibly intense, externally focused intellectual curiosity. We never are together without him and I getting into great discussions on whether it's how global is the globe, what will lead great education, what does it do to make a difference in the world we live in. So his intense curiosity, I think, makes him an ever greater leader. And I'd urge you to do the same. There's nothing more exciting today than the technology tools that Ham will do his best to deliver to all of you to able to enhance your intellectual curiosity. Next, I think of him as a very focused person on customer delight. Not customer satisfaction, but an external focus on customer delight. He identifies who the customer is. He does his very best to make sure that their needs are met and indeed exceeded. When I say delight, I really mean delight. I don't mean satisfaction. Satisfaction's fine. Delight creates a great leader. And Ham thinks of customer delight. Next, I think of him with the need for ever-increasing education. Someone mentioned it earlier today. The best way to learn is to teach. I've done that for years. Ham does that, and he continues to do that. And he'll add education for himself and all of you involved at this university. Equally important is his search for facts as our friends. Today, we live in a world where we're deluged with information. Recently, I read an article of how accurate the headlines are in all the magazines and newspapers we read. How many of you read all the articles, or how many of you read the headlines? Headlines or articles? Some of you have decided not to read anything, apparently, which is probably a good decision. Here were the statistics, the facts. This was the five largest daily newspapers in the United States over a five-year period, over a five-day period. What percentage of the headlines do you think had anything to do with the stories? 19%, one out of five. So when I talk about Ham working hard to make sure facts are our friends, he really does that. And it's critical that you all help him do that so you can set the right priorities and allocate the right resources. Great leaders do that. They set priority and they allocate resources and they do it based on the very best facts that they have at their hands. Finally, I think of Ham as an ICAN leader, I-C-A-N. He's imaginative. As you may know, he was actually originally trained as an architect. And I feel that. When he was in our house a few weeks ago, he walked through and I could tell in 2 minutes he could feel what the architect had been thinking about when he built our house. He does have a great, he is a very imaginative leader. So next is a committed leader. I've never met a person who is more committed to creating success for others than Ham. Next is he's very affirmative. Ham thinks in a positive manner. Ham thinks in a creative manner. And Ham thinks in how do I help everyone win. And perhaps most importantly, Ham never gives up. He never gives up. When he sets an objective and a goal in his life, he makes sure, no matter how long it takes, that he persists and conquers and wins. So when I think of Ham, my friend, I think of an ICAN leader, imaginative, committed, affirmative, and never gives up. So you're in, as I said, for a wonderful ride. The last thing I want to mention about Ham, because I think that exemplifies the individual. He believes, as do I, that the real measure of success is after a leader is gone. Not while the leader's here, but did the leader create an environment, create processes, bring in the right great people, and help everyone be successful? So it's really the legacy that he will leave that you'll all see many years from now that you can be assured will be one that you'll all be very proud of, as I am very proud of my friend Ham. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stead. And it is now my distinct pleasure to invite Chancellor Reed to come forward for the investiture.
Good afternoon. And Jerry, thank you very much. I was worried about what you were going to say, but it sounds like the Board of Trustees did a pretty good job. Before I begin, there's one person that hasn't been introduced, and when you work for these people, you learn that it is important to introduce trustees and former trustees. And I'd like former trustee Tony Vitti to please stand and be recognized. Tomorrow's a very special day for Trustee Vitti, but he served the California State University for 16 years in a very outstanding way. And Tony, thank you for your service. I have often said that choosing a president is one of the most important responsibilities given to the Chancellor and the Board of Trustees. It is a decision that carries a great deal of weight because it not only affects a campus, it affects the entire community. We recognize the important consequences of this decision, and the Board of Trustees takes this responsibility very seriously. That is why, when it came time to choose a leader for the California State University Stanislaus, we chose Hamid Shirvani. Ham came to us with a broad range of higher education experience in both public and private higher education, and in urban and rural settings. He has also brought with him strong leadership, vision, and an ability to connect with the community. We knew that it would take all of these skills to succeed at Stanislaus. He also has a passion for helping the kinds of students that we serve in the California State University. And he is a hard worker who will lead by example. Ham will never ask anybody to do anything that he won't do himself. Under his leadership, I am sure that this university will meet its future challenges and surpass all of our expectations. I am now pleased to give him the official title, President, so that he can continue all of his important efforts. It is now time for the investiture. Will President Shirvani and Trustee Roberta Achtenberg, Chair of the CSU Board of Trustees, please join me at the podium? By the authority granted to me by the Board of Trustees of the California State University, I hereby invest you with the office of President of California State University, Stanislaus, with all the honors, privileges, and the responsibilities thereunto pertaining. Ladies and gentlemen, I am pleased to present President Hamid Shirvani.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon. First, I would like to acknowledge the many people whose support and friendship have made it possible for me to be here today. I'd like to say thank you to Jerry and Mary Joy Stead, who have been both dear friends and mentors to me. I very much appreciate Jerry's inspiring remarks and his confidence in me. And I wish to thank Chancellor Charles Reed for those kind and generous remarks. It's a distinct honor for me to work as a member of Chancellor Reed's team, as he's one of the most prominent leaders in higher education, and he has played a pivotal role in transformation of CSU into one of the true public great institutions of higher education in 21st century. I'm indebted not only to the Chancellor Reed, but also to the CSU trustees who have put their trust in me as their selection for this post as president of this wonderful university. In particular, I would like to publicly thank Trustee Roberta Achtenberg for those gracious remarks, as well as Trustee Deborah Farrar, who served as the search committee chair, Trustee Carol Chandler, Trustee Herb Carter, and Trustee Murray Gallinson, as well as President William Eisenhart, Mr. John Phillips, Dr. Ben Doran, Mr. Ken McCall, class of 72, Dr. Cynthia Morgan, Ms. Jane Rogers, Ms. Chassie Robbins, Professor Stephen Fillings, Professor Fred Hilpert, and Professor Mark Thompson. I would like to acknowledge the trustees who have honored me with their presence today, Ms. Roberta Achtenberg, Chair of the CSU Board of Trustees, Ms. Carol Chandler, Dr. George Gogani, and Mr. Andrew LaFlamme, as well as Trustee Emeritus, Mr. Anthony Vitti, upon whom I have the privilege of conferring an honorary doctorate degree at commencement. I would also like to acknowledge and extend my utmost appreciation
to Trustee and Mrs. Paul Muska of Chapman University, and Honorable Kathleen Pacelli and Honorable Ken Cook, trustees of the City University of New York, and the Turlock City Member Council, City Council Member, Mr. John Lazar, and particularly Senator Jeff Denham. In addition, I wish to acknowledge my fellow university presidents, Dr. Rubin Arminiana, Dr. William Eisenhart, Dr. Alexander Gonzalez, Dr. James Lyons, Dr. John Wetley, Dr. Paul Zing, and Dr. Mohammed Kiami. I'm also pleased to welcome many of my former colleagues, special friends, and family members, particularly my mother, who is with us today, who has traveled many miles and hours to join me on this warm afternoon in Central Valley for this special occasion. I'm grateful to the faculty, staff, and members, of the CSU Stanislaus, who have entrusted me with the honors and responsibility of serving as your president. I'm touched by the remarks made by the representative of the faculty, staff, students, and alumni. I look forward to working with you and getting to know each of you better in the months and years ahead. Finally, I'm grateful to my lovely wife, Fatih, who has been on my side, for her wonderful support, unequivocal support, and unconditional love. Let me begin by expressing my appreciation to the wonderful accomplishments all my predecessors have made, which I will be building upon. We have gathered here today to mark a beginning, the formal inauguration of my work as your new president. I'm both honored and humbled by your trusting me as I work to serve you in this important office. In the months I have been here, I have come to love this campus, its environment, and its people. This is a love I'm certain we share. But what is more important is our shared understanding of the tasks before us, of the critical role the higher education must play in the future our children and our nation will enjoy. My purpose today is to ask you to reflect on the complex and difficult challenges we face in education and the price we will pay if we do not meet them. Because nothing less than economic vitality of our nation and our state rests on our success in meeting these challenges. We are blessed to live in the Golden State. California is one of the wealthiest states in the nation. If we were a nation, our gross product of $1 trillion in 2003 would have ranked us sixth in the world. Yet per pupil spending on K-12 education is below average, and student achievement on national assessment tests ranked us on the bottom sixth state nationwide in 2005. What's going on here? How can we produce so much, enjoy such a high standard of living, and yet fail our children and thus endanger our future? We face both internal and external challenges that will surely test our resolve as we seek to strengthen our educational systems to prepare for the future. The first and most immediate problem we face is coming to grips with the realities of changing demographics of our population. Today, the most highly educated generation in U.S. history, the baby boomers, are retiring. They're being replaced by a growing population of young workers from the nation's least educated groups. Thus, as the boomers retire, the size of our college-educated workforce is shrinking. Because of this education gap, the U.S. is losing much of its competitive advantage in the global marketplace. This national problem is even more severe in California. In just 15 years, the number of Latinos in our working age population will equal that of whites. In fact, by 2020, Latinos will account for more than 40% of a state's population, according to the California Budget Project. Although these statistics fall along racial and ethnic lines, what is significant are the educational implications of these changes. In our current workforce, the disparities are startling. Among whites, 46% have a college degree. Among Latinos, the figure is 12%. Among those who do not have a high school diploma, more than half are Latinos. Only 8% are white. Yet by 2014, more than half of our school-age children will be Latino. Of those, a significant minority will be English learners. Let's put these numbers into a global context. With the increased outsourcing of jobs and growing competition of the rising economies of countries like China and India, we are doomed to falling ever further behind, unless we are willing to radically rethink our educational system from top to bottom. The general failure of public education to meet the challenging needs of our population is system-wide. It's also a problem that has historic roots. There has been a dramatic shift in our thinking about who a college education should be for. Before the Second World War, a college education was not seen as a path for everyone. A liberal arts education was seen as the province of elite, of the privileged classes who by training and temperament would become leaders socially, politically, and economically. From the 50s on, a new way of thinking took hold. A college education became a public function. It was an expectation rather than a privilege. With the rise of the middle class and a growing demand for a highly trained workforce, the value of a high school diploma fell sharply. Today, students without a high school diploma have truly limited career prospects. As an architect, I see a clear parallel between what has happened to public view of higher education and how the general public sees the function of architecture. Until the beginning of 20th century, architecture was a luxury function. Only the rich or governments hired architects. Only recently have ordinary people had either the means or the inclination to hire architects to work on their private buildings and homes. Within the profession, architects struggled to figure out how to serve a mass audience. Whereas earlier architectural movements, such as Art Deco or modernism of 20s and 30s, were pleasing only the elite, serving a broader audience demanded a rethinking of the language of architecture. Today, the vocabulary of architecture has changed. The dominant iconography of that of malls and office buildings in every city in America now reflects a more homey style, one that is attractive to the general public. In other words, architecture has studied the social and cultural context and responded to a changing world. Architecture has learned its lessons, bringing a broader approach to design rather than impose a prescriptive style on design. But what architecture has accomplished, education has failed to do. Where we have failed is to rethink what the content of today's public education should be. We have made some tragic mistakes. In many instances, we have watered down our educational offerings to serve a broader public without rethinking how to retain values of liberal arts education for a more diverse audience. Add to this poor preparation of many students and to the public expectation that a college education should be available to all has resulted in even bigger problems. Today, only 25% of high school graduates in California are truly prepared to attend the university. This shocking statistic comes into even greater relief when we note that this figure is even below dismal 31% of students ready for college on a national level. The new California high school exit exam only requires a student to perform at an 8th grade level in math and 9th and 10th grade levels in reading and writing skills. This dumbing down of expectations is bound to lead our young people to failure. Although California has made modest progress over the last decade in the number of 18 to 24 year olds who have high school diplomas, as well as percentage enrolled in the college, the figures are misleading. Although they enroll, many of these students simply do not graduate or complete the college. Here again, California lags behind other states. We lose more African American and Latino students before they graduate than any other state. What then are the answers? Most people cite money as the answer. Throw more resources at the problem and we can solve it. I cannot discount the importance of a major investment in education. But the solutions go beyond this kind of simplistic response. A recent study by Teach for America reveals what educators in general see as important factors in beginning to solve these problems. Better teachers, high quality academic administrators, setting high expectations for a student performance in the classroom, and providing the mentoring support and resources that will enable students to succeed. Research proves that higher expectations do indeed improve performance. We need to demand better discipline in schools and higher standards for K-12. We need to return to a common curriculum, a curriculum that challenges our students to go beyond routine learning to genuine and critical engagement with ideas. An education that is rigorous and challenging, but also engaging and intellectually exciting. We need to give teachers more authority and independence, and to take the burden of unneeded bureaucracy off their backs. And we need to make sure that our schools of education are doing a better job of preparing K-12 teachers for these tasks. Which brings us back to the central question we are facing here at California State University Stanislaus today. What should we expect from higher education? What do we expect today's colleges and universities to offer our students? How will they be prepared to live and work in a more diverse, increasingly global society? Excuse me. Consider the results of a survey conducted by the American Council of Trustees and Alumni. This survey reports that higher education today offers from, and I quote, a hollow core. We live in an era when the iron hands of political correctness can push sanity out the window. When a course on Persian miniatures is proposed for general education credit, or a course in the history of comic book art can replace a solid grounding in art history, neither the student nor the society is well served. I say that not because I do not think that such courses are interesting, but because we have to make tough choices between essentials and electives. We have lost our sense of direction by trying to be all things to all people. We have lost the courage of our convictions that a college education should produce a literate young man or woman capable of conversing in the languages of arts and sciences. We have relaxed our grip on the standards that will enable our state and our nation to remain competitive in a global economy. I'm not suggesting that we return to the days of an education delivered only for the elite, or an education that is static and shrinks its responsibility to engage students and professors in vigorous debate about the content of education. Rather, I am suggesting that we must reinvent undergraduate education so it provides a solid educational foundation. We must continue to demand that today's students work harder, and we must deliver a higher level of content in college courses that we expect them to master. At the same time, we must recognize that the students of all backgrounds are capable of doing college-level work as it was traditionally conceived. Many of our colleagues believe that first-generation college students and English learners cannot be taught a traditional liberal arts or great books curriculum. I am living proof that this is not true. People like me, who grew up elsewhere, can and should be expected to study the same curriculum that has traditionally defined an educated person. People like me, particularly those from a non-Western culture, need to know the texts that are the basis of the majority of international laws today. To serve all of our students, we must identify areas where we have watered down requirements. We must recognize that we cannot follow the hot jobs of the moment and function as a trade school. We must go back to our educational roots to provide an education that helps our young people learn how to learn. Once they understand the language of mathematics or the scientific method, today's graduate can continue to learn on their own, even as the demands of the workplace change over time. Our challenge is to show students that the education we offer is informed by strong curricula taught by true teacher scholars. Our challenge is to show students the advantages of committing 4 or more years of their lives to a real education delivered by real people. Here at California State University Stanislaus, we have many programs in place to tackle some of these critical problems. Already, CSU Stanislaus has a record of success in important endeavors that will help us address the needs of our changing population. We are one of the 12 campuses cited in the national study by the American Association of State Colleges and Universities for creating a campus culture that has helped improve student success and resulted in higher than predicted graduation rates. We have consistently placed on the top half of CSU campuses in freshman graduation and overall retention rate. Our 6-year graduation rate is one of the best in the California State University system. We are ranked among the nation's top 100 colleges for bachelor's degrees awarded to Hispanic students. One key reason for this success is the outstanding faculty mentoring we believe in. Our faculty are deeply committed to the success of our students and make themselves available to provide the help and support that enables our students to thrive and succeed. Just one example of this kind of faculty leadership and commitment is pioneering work our faculty have done to help both pre-college students and teachers improve their math skills, with a particular emphasis on encouraging young women to consider math and science careers. We have been recognized by numerous awards for this important and innovative approach to helping students succeed. We are also helping to recruit and retain teachers for high needs schools through a $3.3 million grant from U.S. Department of Education. Working in partnership with Modesto City Schools, our education students are learning effective ways to help students overcome language, cultural, or economic barriers to academic success. In Stockton, we are partnering with Aspire Public Schools to open a charter school this fall to help prepare students from low-income families for college. We are contributing to our communities in other ways through faculty-student collaboration and research. For example, the CSU Stanislaus Endangered Species Recovery Program has teamed university faculty and staff with state and federal agency experts in since 1992 to restore rare and endangered plant and animal life in the region. This program has brought in not only millions of dollars in grants, but more importantly, has had a significant impact on the ecological health and diversity of our region. This depth of commitment to our community is expressed in other ways as well. For example, many of our professors emeriti are so committed to teaching that even though they are officially retired, they continue to teach as volunteers. Not only is this kind of dedication to working with our young people praiseworthy, it speaks to the very heart and soul of this institution. When you have faculty that dedicated, you can be sure that they are the kinds of individuals who truly engage our students and shape their lives as students and teachers share a lifelong intellectual journey together. Our success is evoking the passion and excitement of a lifetime of learning is seen in the lives of our many alumni who are leaders in their work and in their communities. CSU Stanislaus can count among its graduates, young men and women, who are shaping the future in a wide range of disciplines and endeavors. From major developers who are building our homes and businesses, to those who continue to build on the great agricultural legacy of this valley. Our alumni include doctors and lawyers, politicians and teachers, the next generation who look to their alma mater to play a significant role as together we build our community and our state. To meet their expectations and those of our current students and students yet to come, we have created 6 unique and outstanding colleges: the College of the Arts, the College of Business, the College of Humanities and Social Sciences, the College of Natural Sciences, the College of Human and Health Sciences, and the College of Education. Together, these distinctive units and the incredible faculty driving them are the foundation for the comprehensive educational offerings we are privileged to offer through CSU Stanislaus. But this can only be a beginning. Our goals are simple. We are here to serve our community. We expect to serve more students, building on our current strong programs and adding new programs as needed to serve the Central Valley. We will continue to recruit top faculty. We hope to transform Turlock into a college town, completing the marriage of town and gown. We have continued to expand our education. We will continue to expand our student services, our athletics program, and every component of a Stanislaus experience to attract and retain the best students. In other words, we will be a university of choice. I truly hope that this is a real inauguration. We need to inaugurate a new era in education, one that is committed to fostering a new and greater vision of public education that isn't afraid to tackle tough, pragmatic problems in order to make this vision a reality. We need to begin to set higher, not lower, expectations. And we need to begin today, not only for our own sakes, but for the sake of generations yet to come. California is still the golden state. How long it remains so is up to us. I invite you to join me as we undertake this critical task. Our young people should expect no less of us, and we should expect no less of ourselves. Thank you for your attention and your trust.
And now I'd like to ask Trustee Actenberg to deliver a few closing words.
President Shirvani, this has been a very special day for all of us. On behalf of the Board of Trustees and all of those assembled, I want to thank you very much for those inspiring words. They'll give us something to remember and to think about and to take action with regard to. I want to thank all of you for being here. Many thanks to the staff and the faculty and the students who have helped make this event possible. The California State University Stanislaus is proud, a proud establishment. We are proud of our new president. This community will thrive as a result of your leadership, and we are blessed all to be here together today in President Shirvani's honor. To your wonderful and loving family, to this embracing community, we want to offer our congratulations and say thank you for the work that you will accomplish in all of our names.
Would you all please rise to sing the university's alma mater and remain standing for the following benediction. I present Father Joseph Illo, pastor of St. Joseph Catholic Church in Modesto, who will deliver the benediction.
Before we bow our heads in a final prayer for grace and blessing upon our new president,
we listen briefly to the words of Scripture from the fifth chapter of St. Matthew's Gospel. Jesus went up the mountain and he began to teach. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city set on a mountain cannot be hidden. Your light must shine before others, so that they may see your good deeds and glorify your heavenly Father. Let us pray. God our Father, your spirit of wisdom fills the earth and instructs us in your ways. Be pleased, we beseech you, to bless and guide this university and its new president, Hamid Shirvani. Help him to fulfill his responsibilities worthily and well. Almighty God, as all earthly powers must serve you, let us strive to serve your truth. May our new president, faculty, staff, and students together build a society of greater peace and justice. May the authority you have granted our new president bear lasting fruit at this university and in this community. We entrust this prayer to you, who live and reign eternally. Amen.
Thank you, Father. It's now time for the recessional. Once the platform party, faculty, and delegates have exited the tent, I invite you to join us for a reception by the Sequoia Lake, just to the west of here. Please come to greet President Shirvani and mingle with your friends and colleagues, and thank you very much for being here today. Mr. Campbell, would you please step forward and lead the recessional? Thank you.